Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage Matraca Berg, Lee Smith, Jill McCorkle, and Marshall Chapman.
Wow. It's great to be here tonight at my age. It's great to be anywhere, particularly here. Let's see. So she introduced us, and 20 years ago, my phone rang, and it was Matraca Berg, who I did not know. She said, "Marshall, I want to do a musical, and I want to do it with you, and I want to do it with Lee Smith." She said, "Do you know Lee?" And I said, "Well, yeah, but I hadn't seen her in a while," because Lee used to live in Nashville with her first husband. And
first of many.
And so I immediately called Lee. I had her old address. She had moved from Chapel Hill to Hillsboro. But I finally found her. I said, "Okay, Lee, I just got a phone call from Matraca Berg." "Oh, I just love Matraca. I just love Matraca." And so I told her what Matraca said, and her response was that she wanted to do a musical called Good Old Girls with me and with her. Lee said, "Oh." And I thought, well, you know, I've carried the message now. I can go about my business. And then I got a phone call from Lee the next day, and she said, and she was all excited, and she said, "Oh, I just went to a cocktail party in Chapel Hill, and we've got a director. And we're going to bring in Jill McCorkle." And I didn't know Jill. So we had this musical called Good Old Girls that ended up opening off-Broadway. And every now and then some, you know, theater like this will show it, and we'll all get a check for $70 or something. And but more importantly, we got to know each other, really. I was intimidated by Matraca. She'd just come off having 6 number one songs. And so I was kind of scared of her. And then later she told me she was scared of me because of my badass rock and roll attitude. So I don't know how this happened, but we have become great friends. And once a year, we get together to do a benefit. And we've been doing that for 20 years. 2 years ago, we were in Beaufort, South Carolina, raising money for the Pat Conroy Literary Center. Yeah, thank you. They like raising money here. They're good about that. That's why this town's so beautiful. I wish Nashville's got a lot to learn from Spartanburg. I won't go into that. What am I talking about?
I don't know.
You know, we've played Charlotte. We've done benefits for women's shelters. Just all over, and about once a year. We've never rehearsed. We don't know what we're gonna do, but we're gonna do something. And let's see, in April, we played a show in Nashville at the Belcourt Theater to raise money for the Vanderbilt Libraries. I went to Vanderbilt, and I did not know that Vanderbilt has 9 libraries. So we did that. I mean, I only went to the one library maybe 4 times the whole time I was there. I'm kind of allergic to, I get in libraries and I start sneezing, but but after we did that show, I'm just going to lay it out. Lee, tomorrow is her birthday, and she's going to be 75 years old.
Thank you.
And yours truly right here, it just turned, no, I'll be 71 in January. So after we, and I'm not going to mention, but we hit the spectrum here. But after we did that show in Nashville, Lee said something. I said, "Lee, you got to be careful about what you say because it might come true." She said, "You know, we really ought to film this before one of us becomes pathetic." And so I thought, I remembered playing here and how great it was and how much y'all supported when I've been here. And so we were going to do it here, and I think we had 2 other places in mind. By God, we've ended up in Spartanburg, South Carolina. We're proud to be here. Before one of us becomes pathetic. So we're just going to do what we do, and Matraca, kick us off there with a little chorus of your song.
Yeah, this is a song that inspired a musical that we all were a part of that Paul Ferguson at UNC adapted from all of our existing work. And it was called Good Old Girls. And this is the song. And I wrote it with the late, great Randy Scruggs. So let's sing you a chorus. She's a good old girl, and she won't let you down. She's got a picture of Elvis when he came to her town, and her heart is kind. Oh, but she speaks her mind. Just cross her one time. She's a good old girl. Yeah, she's a good old girl.
Jill and I both seem to write a lot about good old girls, as a matter of fact, and one of my favorite ones made her way out of a book into the script of the show, and I'll just read you a little bit about her. Her name is Chanel, and this is going out to Kelly Warner, who's in the audience here, who played in the first production of Good Old Girls. She played Chanel. Okay, and so I'm gonna just read a little bit from Chanel. Okay, I want you to imagine that we're in the Caribbean on a yacht, and a girl named Chanel is talking to us. Chanel is not her original name, of course. Her name was May Ruth back in Eastern Kentucky, but that's another story. This is Chanel. Mama always said, talk real sweet, and you can have whatever you want. This is true, though it does not hurt to have a nice bust either. Since I was blessed early on in both the voice and bosom departments, I got the hell out of Eastern Kentucky at the first opportunity and never looked back. That's how Mama raised us, not to get stuck like she did. Mama grew up hard and married young and worked her fingers to the bone and wanted us to have a better life. Be nice, she always said. Please people and marry rich. After several tries, I'm finally on the verge of this, but it has been a lot of work, believe me. I'm a very high maintenance woman. It is not easy to look the way I do. Some surgery has been involved. But I tell you, what with the miracles of modern medicine available to our fingertips, I do not know why more women don't go for it. Just go for it. This is my motto. And I feel that Larry is finally making a real commitment by bringing me along on this yacht this weekend. And I've cleared the decks for action. Larry's already left his marriage, psychologically. So, the rest is just a matter of time. Well, baby, what do you think? Paradise, huh? This is my fiancé and employer, Larry Markham, who deserves a little trip to paradise if anybody ever did. I've never known anybody to work so hard. Larry started off as a paving contractor and still thinks you can never have too much concrete. This is also true of gold, in my opinion, as well as shoes. Honey, this is fabulous, I tell Larry, and it is. Turquoise blue water so clear you can see right down to the bottom where weird fish are swimming all around. big old birds, strange, jagged, picturesque mountains popping up behind the beaches on several of these islands we're passing. What's the name of these islands again, I ask. And Larry tells me,
the Grenadines.
Well, there is a drink called that, I say. And Larry says,
is there, baby?
And kisses me. He is such a hard worker that he has missed out on everything cultural. Kissing Larry is not really great, but okay. Honey, you need you some sunscreen, I tell him when he's through. He has got that kind of red-headed complexion that will burn like mad in spite of a stupid hat. You need to put it everywhere, all over you. On your feet now. Here, put your foot up on the chair, I tell him. And he does. And I rub sunscreen all over his fat white feet, one after the other, and his ankles and his calves right up to those baggy plaid shorts. This is something I will not do after we're married.
All I want is everything on a silver platter and a champagne glass. All I want is everything, baby, that shouldn't be too much to ask. All I want is everything. All I want is everything. All I want is a Cadillac, kind that Elvis drove down Bale. He'll be riding in the back with you and me, baby, behind that wheel. All I want is everything. All I want is everything. It's a big old world. It's a big old world. It's a big old world, and I'm a greedy girl. It's a big old girl, and I'm a greedy girl. Woo! All I want is all your loving. Feel the earth move when we kiss. I don't need me a big old diamond, but baby, I will take it if you insist. All I want is everything. All I want is everything. All I want is everything.
Testing. It's early in the morning on June, oh what the hell, June something, and I'm tooling right down Interstate 95 to my new life. I just bought this cheap little recorder in an all-night diner where they had a lot of crap at the checkout. I also bought a rape whistle and a mood ring like I once had when I was in the ninth grade. I could have bought some fruit-flavored condoms if that tells you what place I was in, but I passed. I've taken a vow of celibacy. So relieved as hell to be out of the life that is now 4 hours behind me in the D.C. area. I plan to tell all on these tapes, my life, my secrets. I mean, why not? I'm driving along thinking that that big old meteor or whatever it was that hit Jupiter could just as easily slam into Earth and wipe us all out. And wouldn't I be sorry if I'd stayed in a miserable life? Wouldn't I be sorry if I'd spent my days fretting over this calorie or that? Just prior to entering the marriage I'm now leaving, I was driving down this same interstate, and what did I see but a big white horse racing down the side of the road? At first, I thought it was hallucinating, and then I thought it was a sign, like from Revelation, coming for to carry me home or some such. Of course, then I saw this red-faced farmer hauling ass with a harness clutched in his hand and a deserted plow out in the middle of a tobacco field. Still, I should have taken heed. If a friend had told me that story, I'd have said it's a sign, stay single. I've always been asked for advice by others. It comes to me naturally whether I want the position or not. It's like all I have to do is walk into a room, and within 5 minutes, everybody who's anybody with a problem has come up and affixed himself to me. I think of myself as a crazy magnet. I say, step right up, put on your iron filing suit and get sucked my way. Give me your lost and crazed. Are you on drugs? Are you afraid to come out of the closet? Do you like to tell others every graphic detail of your sex life or intestinal functions? Well, then clearly I'm the woman you've spent your life looking for. The trouble is that I'm so damn sick and tired of listening to all your crap, I've decided to set up shop and just talk to myself for a few months. Since all of you problem types out there just don't happen to ever have time to listen. If you're listening to these tapes, then there's a very good chance that I'm dead. So fine, listen. Sit back and enjoy yourself. My name is Betty Denise Parks, but everybody calls me Betty just like the restaurant. I'm 35 years old and on my way to Fulton, North Carolina, where I have a job waiting for me. I'm going to put my crazy magnet properties to good use and become a therapist. I've never been a therapist. I only took introduction to psych in college, where I majored in recreation. Serious recreation, of course. I've spent the past several years going into rest homes and tossing balls of yarn into hands too old to catch and helping the more virile types glue dried beans onto boards in shapes of chickens and sunrises and so on. People say I'm very good at what I do. People were crazy about me in Virginia, where I lived as the wife of an academic, an English professor who spent his whole life researching writers who had allergies. As a result, he spent an enormous amount of time studying the sneeze, what part of the brain controlled it, bright lights, so on. He couldn't shut up about that French guy who liked to watch others, if you know what I mean, and otherwise stayed corked up in his room his entire life writing one really long book, and then that woman poet from Boston whose name I can't think of either. He referred to them as the asthmatics, which I said sounded like a punk rock band that might be into leather and little face masks like Dennis Hopper used in Blue Velvet. People said my husband must be such an interesting person. Yeah, right. That's why I felt inclined to take off all my clothes while watching Body Heat in a public theater. William Hurt was so close I could have spit a raisinette and hit him. I was almost shed of everything when the manager of the theater came and asked me to put my clothes back on, and then somebody called my husband to come and get me. He was so mad, his jaw clenched tightly. I faked several sneezes to distract him and went on about my business. I knew I was out of there. Anyway, I'm signing off for right now. As I say, if you're listening to my secret tapes, then chances are I'm dead. And I hope that it's something like the year 2050 instead of this year. I hope that I fell in love with a wonderful person, had a couple of kids, a lucrative career, vegetable garden, rose arbor, good clothes, and leather accessories. I hope that people remember me fondly as a woman who had much insight into the lost and crazed who attached themselves to her. I hope people forget that I was stripping my clothes off in a public theater about the same time that poor Pee Wee Herman was doing things in another theater. And I shouldn't have reminded you of that peewee just now, in hopes that people will have forgotten all about his little episode and that his program will be back on the air. I think of myself as the Peewee Defense Commission. I hope that out there in the world somewhere, I will have people who feel that way about me. And I'll delete what I just said, come to think of it. What I just now did reminds me of a card I once saw on an airplane when I was seated in that emergency exit seat. The card said, if you cannot perform in the event of an emergency or you cannot read this card, please alert your attendant. Duh. Anyway, I hope I'm remembered in a wonderful way. I hope my funeral will be a happy time. I'd like to be cremated and thrown from the Empire State Building with a little bit left over for my remaining loved ones to put in velvet bags and preserve like secret talismans. I want to be hurled to the wind on a bright, clear, sunny day. I want low humidity so that my pieces will not stick like so much cheap cinder to the soot that already fills the city air. I want my pieces to blow. I'd like for people to tell stories. My funeral songs of choice are Be Young, Be Foolish, Be Happy by the Tams and Already Gone by the Eagles. If it turns out that I've died young, then I hope the sky will darken and the rain will fall. I hope that people will stop what they're doing and fill my loss like a big empty hole just for a second before they turn back to their televisions and telephones and video display terminals. Because the truth is that if that has happened, then it's a damn shame. It's a big damn loss. It brings tears to my eyes just to think of it.
Betty's out being bad tonight. Betty and a boyfriend, they had a big fight. She found out what everybody knew. Too many cooks spoil the stew. She don't care what nobody thinks. She's gonna be bad till the whole town stinks. Betty's being bad. Betty's being bad. Y'all help me. How bad?
Bad, bad, bad.
Y'all got it. She's out being bad. Betty's out being bad tonight. You know, Betty and her boyfriend had a big fight. Yeah, now she went home when she found out. Said, pack your bags, I want you out. Her boyfriend thought she was talking jive to him. Saw her standing with a 45. 45's quicker than 409. Betty cleaned the house for the very last time. Betty's being bad. Betty's being bad. How bad?
Bad, bad, bad.
Betty's out being bad tonight. You know, Betty and her boyfriend had a big fight. Now, if you go home and you see Betty, don't know. If you go out and you see Betty, don't scream and shout unless you're ready. You're ready to rock, ready to roll. Till hell freezes over and you catch a cold. Betty's not mad, she's just getting even. Betty's being bad, that's her way of leaving. Betty's being bad. Betty's being bad. How bad?
Bad, bad, bad.
Whoa, she's out being bad. Betty's out being bad tonight. You know, Betty and her boyfriend, they had a big fight. Bye, bye, Betty, goodbye. Ba 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 ba. Bye bye, Betty, goodbye. Bye bye, bye bye, bye Betty, goodbye. Bye bye, bye bye, bye bye, Betty, goodbye. Bye bye, bye bye, bye bye, Betty, goodbye.
Thank you. Matraca's tuning. Matraca and I have a song that, well, we started writing and then we realized there needed to be a third writer because we'd already stolen from that person.
That's true.
We saw this title to one of Jill McCorkle's short stories And if there was ever a great title for a country song, that was one. So we wrote the song, and since we stole the whole plot from her short story, we gave her 1/3 of the writer's credit. And it was in Good Old Girls, and also Trisha Yearwood ended up recording it. So we signed. Now, not only is this is a wonderful, decorated author, brilliant, now she's a country songwriter, she's got that. We signed her up to BMI, told her to clean it, get the cobwebs out of your mailbox, baby. Here we go.
She said, honey, you don't know me, but I feel like I know you. And do you mind if I come in? It'll only take a minute or two. And by the way, I really like what you've done to this place. But it doesn't really surprise me, hon. We kind of have the same taste. But that's enough small talk. There's something we need to discuss. Your husband cheating on us. Yeah. Then she said, you look surprised. Well, I'm surprised. You never knew. And I can't believe you didn't see or pick up on my rather strong perfume. Anyway, we've been replaced. She's much younger than me and you. And I know she's out there with him now, doing things we used to do. But if we got together, don't you think we'd be dangerous? Your husband's cheating on us. He's cheating on us, girl.
Snakes are in the kitchen and crows are on the line. Can't you see the sign?
And this is where I started to cry, and she said, oh, honey, you'll get over it. And never mind my fantasies of cyanide or taking out a hit. Anyway, it's better, don't you think, to make him wish that he was dead. And promise me you'll take that creep for everything he's ever had instead. I got a Polaroid camera and a room number at the Hotel Nautilus. Well, your husband's cheating on us. Yeah. Snakes are in the kitchen and crows are on the line. Where the faint is twitching. Can't you see the signs? Husband's cheating on us.
Okay, well, this is actually a true story. And it's named Romantic Fever. The house I grew up in was one of a row of houses strung along a narrow river bottom like a string of beads between the mountains. I was in love with my best friend's father. Three houses down the road, Mr. Owens had huge, dark, soulful eyes, thick black hair, a mustache that dropped down on either side of his mouth, and the prettiest singing voice available. Every night after supper, he'd sit out in his garden by the river and play his guitar and sing for Martha and me and every other kid in the neighborhood who'd gather around to listen. Mr. Owens played songs like Wayfaring Stranger and the Alabama Waltz. He died the year we were 13 from an illness described as romantic fever. Though later I would learn that the first word was actually rheumatic. In my own mind, it remained romantic fever, an illness I associated with those long summer evenings when my beloved Mr. Owens played the old sad songs while lightning bugs rose like stars from the misty weeds along the Black River as night came on. The link between love and death intensified when my MYF group, that's the Methodist Youth Fellowship, went to Myrtle Beach, where we encountered many exotic things, such as pizza pie and northern boys smoking cigarettes on the boardwalk. Our youth leader, who was majoring in drama at a church school, threw our cigarettes into the surf and led us back up onto the sandy porch of Mrs. Fickling's boarding house for an emergency lecture on petting. A nice girl, she said dramatically, does not pet. It is cruel to the boy to allow him to pet because he has no control over himself. He is just a boy. It is all up to the girl. If she allows the boy to pet her, then he will become excited. And if he cannot find relief, then the poison will back up into his organs, causing pain and sometimes death. She spat out the words. We drew back in horror and fascination. Of course, it wasn't long before I found myself in the place where I'd been headed all along. The front seat of a rusty old pickup, heading up a mountain on a dark gravel road with a wild older boy. Let's call him Wayne. I think they were all named Wayne. Whom I scarcely knew but had secretly adored for months. This was not the nice boy I'd been dating, the football star slash student government leader who carried my books around from class to class all year and held my hand in study hall. My friends were all jealous of me for attracting such a nice boyfriend. Even my mother approved. But though he dutifully pressed his body against mine at dances in the gym whenever they played the 12th of Never, our song, it just wasn't happening. That fiery hand did not clasp my vitals as it did in Jane Eyre whenever she encountered Mr. Rochester. So, I had seized my chance when Wayne asked me if I'd like to ride around sometime. You bet, I'd said so fast it seemed to startle him. I'd love to. Wayne was a big, slow-talking boy with long black hair that fell down into his handsome, sullen face. He wore a ring of keys on his belt and a pack of cigarettes rolled up in the sleeve of his t-shirt. He did not play sports. Wayne smoked, drank, and played in a band with grown-up men. He was always on the absentee hot list. And soon he'd be gone for good, headed off to Nashville with a shoebox full of songs. We jolted up the rutted road through dense black woods. My mother would have died if she'd known where I was, but she didn't.
Nobody did. I was determined to pet with Wayne, even if it killed him. Finally, we emerged onto a kind of dark, windy plateau, an abandoned strip mine site on top of the mountain. He drove right up to the edge, a sheer drop. I caught my breath. On the mountainside below us were 100 coke ovens sending their fiery blasts like giant candles straight up into the sky. It was like the pit of hell itself, but beautiful. It was the most beautiful thing I'd ever seen. For some reason, I started crying. "Aw," he said. He screwed the top off a mason jar and gave me a drink, which burned all the way down. "You know what?" He pulled me over toward him. "He smelled like smoke, like alcohol, like the woods." "What?" I said into his blue jean jacket. "There's a boy killed in one of them ovens last month. Fell in or throwed himself in, nobody ever did know which." "Was there?" I scooted closer. "Yep, boy from over on Pawpaw. Had a wife and two little babies gone in the twinkling of an eye, just like it says in the Bible." He snapped his fingers, "Right down there," he said into my hair. "That's awful," I shuddered, turning up my face for his kiss. While below us, the coke ovens burned like 100 red fountains of death, and I felt the fiery hand clutch my vitals for good. Finally, I thought, romantic fever.
"Don't make me pregnant. I just want to dance. Let's stop and think it over before we take that chance. If you make me pregnant, I won't take it very well. I'll go home to my mama, and you can go to hell." "9 months is such precious time when you're only 17. I'm the girl they say will be homecoming queen. And it's only once that we get the chance to be what we will be. I want to dance. So if you dance with me, don't start thinking maybe, baby, that I'm gonna love you after all. 'Cause I don't wanna have a baby. Everybody, I just want to have a ball."
Well, there's two things I like to do better than anything else in this world, even at my age, and one of them is talk. Y'all can guess what the other one is. A while back, Roy and me were in the bed. That's my husband, Roy. And I said this out loud to him. It's something I have thought to myself for a while. "Roy," I said, "when you get right down to it, honey, there's not a lot worth doing, is there, outside of this and talking?" Well, Roy wrinkled up his eyes in that way he has, and he thought for the longest time, and then he said, "Well, Sally, I guess there's sports." "Sports?" I laughed so loud, but that's Roy for you. He'd roll over and die if he missed a bowl game on the TV. One time, he didn't get up from that recliner for 7 hours solid. and his niece went right out from under him when he stood up when the news come on. Roy likes his sports, and he likes my kids, and he likes pepperoni pizza, and he likes to have him some beer of an evening. I do too. And he'll grow him some tomatoes every year out there by the garage. He likes tomatoes. And he likes engines. Better than any man you ever saw, any kind of an engine. Roy likes cars and boats. And Roy can fuck your eyes out. Roy can, and talking all the time. Talk to me, baby, he says. Well, I like that. I didn't run into Roy till I was over the hill. I had this other husband first. But by God, I know a good thing when I see it. I jumped right on it. Because him and me, we're two of a kind. And sometimes when they're there in the bed, it's like it all gets mixed up some way. Like you kind of forget where your body stops and his starts, or who did what to who and who came when and all that. I said, we're two of a kind. Most people, in my opinion, are too busy looking all around to stop and see what they've already got. Not me. I know what I've got. I've got Roy. And you might not think it to look at him, but honey, my Roy is a dream come true.
Well, Matraca's tune, and this is a song that she sings that goes with Lee's reading. But I remember sitting at home when I didn't know Matraca, and I was watching the CMA Awards show, and there was this gorgeous vision and wrapped in a beautiful blue shawl, and she sang this song, and it just blew everybody in America's mind.
I guess you had to be there, she said, you had to be. She handed me a yellow photograph and then said, see, this was my greatest love. My one and only love, and this is me. Back when we were beautiful, see, I don't feel very different, she said. I know it's strange. I guess I've gotten used to these little aches and pains. But I still love to dance. You know we used to dance the night. Back when we were beautiful, yeah. I hate it when they say I'm aging gracefully. I fight it every day. I guess they never see. I don't like. What's happening to me? To me. But I really love my grandma. kids, she said, they're sweet to hold. They would have loved their grandpa, those awful jokes he told. You know, sometimes for a laugh, the two of us would act like we were old. Back when we were beautiful, yeah. But I guess you had to be
Carter wishes she was dead. Ralph is. It's been almost a year since Ralph died, her niece Hannah says, but it seems like yesterday or 3 weeks, what with all that hullabaloo making her house like a regular hellhole. Next thing she knew, Hannah had her name stamped in all her underwear and had her here at this school. Old people, God, old and ugly, looking like fools, walk by her door near that all day, and some stop and stand there sipping on some old Pepsi Cola or shit, who knows, like she might ask them to come in, and she doesn't. Hell no, ain't about to ask some old drooling fool into her house. She's already got one that stays there with her, a woman with the filthiest hair that Lena's ever seen. You could fry an egg on a hot day on her head, and that woman just walks back and forth. She walks back and forth till it makes Lena dizzy. Wear out the damn rug, Lena told her, and the fool said, I will, sister, I will, God willing, and I will. Shh. God don't have a thing to do with it. God ain't at this school, and who can blame him? The food makes you sick. They don't put one grain of salt on one grain of nothing. I'd love to have me some of them butter cookies, her roommate says 10,000 times a day. I'd love some. Yes, sister, I would. God willing, and I would. Tell God about it then, Lena had said one day. And that woman stopped her pacing and just grinned, nodded and grinned. I do, sister, I do. She went right back to pacing, and Lena told her she didn't have one sister on this, but one sister on this earth, and that her sister lived at home where she ought to be, and not in this school where men pee on the floor if they take a notion and nobody cares. There's pee on the floor, she told that fat woman in the white suit, and he did it. She pointed to that old man that chews tobacco all day long without a tooth in his head. Now, let's not be ugly, Miss Carter, that woman said. God, ugly, ugly and old. All of them are as old as dirt, and who in the hell wants to talk or be here at this hotel school where nothing's going on except bingo, where you don't get a damn thing but maybe a comb or a sucker like you might be retarded. Let's play for money, she said one day, or cigarettes. And that nurse teacher said, now, Mrs. Carter. And Lena said, stop with that Mrs. Carter shit, because Mr. Carter's dead and the food makes her sick. Sick, and people pee on the floor for a person like herself who can still walk to slip and break a neck. She hadn't learned one damn thing at this school, not one, and that's fine. Don't need such a school. Live and learn and die and forget it all. Ralph used to say that. Ralph said that, and he said, walk softly and carry a big stick. He said, do unto others before they do it to you. Damn right. She's worn this outfit five days in a row, and she don't care if she wears it for the sixth. They say, let's slip off your clothes and take a little bath. Little bath, nothing. She isn't gonna take off her clothes for people crazy as hell. Can't even get room service in this hotel. Gotta go to the school cafeteria and walk down a line if you're able, and then sit there with people that can't even get a bite to their lips. "You close your mouth so I can't see," she told one woman, and that woman smiled at her, smiled. And there's another one that sits there all day saying, "Get Billy, get Billy. Billy is dead, dead, dead. Billy is in the school for the dead, where we all ought to be instead of this here school Holiday Inn." Now that woman stops rocking and looks at her, tears in them old eyes that look like if they could see anything, they shouldn't be able to. "Dead, I say, Billy's dead." She leans closer to that woman and puts her own cheek on the other side of the woman's head. "I wish I was dead," she whispers. And that woman doesn't say a word, just stares off past the baby's head. "But I'm going to get Billy right now," she whispers. And that woman looks at her and squints up those old cloudy eyes. "As soon as I find Ralph, we'll go get Billy. Me and Ralph have got a great big car."
It doesn't matter where you're coming from. It doesn't matter what damage was done. We're all on a journey. Our goal is the same. We're gonna be happy like children again. So be your own parent and treat yourself good. It's never too late to have a happy childhood. That's right. I used to think freedom meant running away, and love was a feeling that never would stay. I searched this world over, but I never found a big enough shoulder to muffle the sound. So cry if you need to, it might do you good. It's never too late to have that happy childhood. That's right. Some never make it, some never try, some try to fake it, some barely get by. Survival is easy, it's that living that's hard. And it takes lots of courage just to be who you are. So do what you love, not what they say you should. It's never too late to have a happy child. That's right. Never too late.
Best friends is here tonight. They drove all the way up here from Sumter, South Carolina. All right. I love, when I told Kim I'd been hanging out with Lee Smith, I talked to her on the phone one time. She says, "I'm at my gynecologist right now in the stirrups. I'm reading one of her novels right now."
Thank you.
I just thought I'd share that with y'all.
Starting to feel real close to y'all.
new things.
You gonna do your thing, and then your new song.
I know you might wonder why I spend so much time filling these notebooks, but I've done it for years now, and the practice is simply a part of my life, a way to clear my mind and to remember. Sometimes I just record the weather, something simple about the day. It's so easy to let them all run together. I had years that were that way, and I find such loss troubling. Better to try to define something, the premature blue dusk of a winter afternoon or the long clear light of summer, that kind of light that makes you feel immortal. And I guess that's why we hold on to our bits and pieces in the first place, because we aren't immortal. And though denial fills our days and years, especially those that have slipped away, that kernel of truth is always lodged within. We all are haunted by something, something we did or didn't do, and the passing years either add to the weight or diminish it. Mine have diminished, perhaps because I've spent time thinking about it all. It might sound silly, but I see these bits and pieces as my contribution to evolution, the unearthing and dusting of the prints and markers that led me here. Some seem to bulldoze right through life and up to their headstones, but I want to take my time. I want to find the right words. I imagine my recipient to be you, or perhaps your children, and I hope this is so rather than some stranger who comes in to hoist old boxes into a dumpster or rake away the remainders of my life like the sad debris in the aftermath of a flood or fire. I'll never get over the sight of what we left behind at our home of over 50 years to move here, a mountain of cast-off things, old towels and linens, papers and books and shoes and pots, side tables, lamps, hoses and hose, and packets of seeds I meant to plant, and a rubber squeak toy that had been safely hidden away in the back of my closet by one of the dogs long dead, and so much more. Things not needed, things long forgotten, cans of cream of whatever soup and V8 juice, why? And peas that had sat there forgotten for years, and things that never should have been there in the first place, like tuna helper, or those things in my closet, like that geometric print mini dress I bought in the 60s, hoping to look like Petula Clark or Judy Carn, a perky pixie kind of dress that I never had the nerve to wear, and instead looked at it there at the back of the closet for years, along with a wiglet and a long frosted fall and some jackets with shoulders resembling a football player or Victorian monarch. A mountain of cast-offs that we then divided into goodwill, consignment, recycle, landfill. In short, I'm homesick and I'm time sick. I would be lying not to say that. It's possible to feel content and resolved and still be homesick. I miss all that no longer is, which is why I paste and piece all these scraps together. Sometimes I hold a ticket or photo, a piece of paper, while wheeling myself back to where I first held it. I know that might sound silly, but it's what I do. I want to hear your young voices, the dog scratching to come in. I want to call my father on the telephone, finger in that rotary dial, one number at a time, TW33642. Let me take this playbill and arrive at the theater, or this receipt and find myself there in the produce aisle of Star Market. Then after the show, or after I check out, after I sit and let the car warm up, I drive those familiar streets home and find everything just as I left it, the kitchen door creaking behind me.
I can't wait to read that. I get lost in my hometown. Since they tore the drive-in down, I find myself all turned around. get lost in my hometown. I'm getting hard to recognize. They say the mirror never lies, but I've still got my mama's eyes. I'm getting hard to recognize. The years go by like days sometimes. The days go by like years. And I don't know which one I hate the most. At the same old busted table, in the same old kitchen chair, I'm drinking coffee and arguing with ghosts, arguing with ghosts. There's a picture on we got married in the fall, and I don't know those kids at all. There's a picture on the wall. I light one cigarette a day. I watch it burn and I walk. A wisp of smoke in your old ashtray. I light one cigarette a day. And the years go by like days sometimes. The days go by like years. And I don't know which one I hate the most. At the same old kitchen table, in the same old busted chair, I'm drinking coffee and arguing with ghosts, arguing with ghosts, arguing. I get lost in my home. Since they tore the driving down, I find myself all turned around. I get lost in my hometown.
Wow.
We got any English teachers in the audience? Any teacher? Any teachers at all? We got any? Is my former in-law Betsy Jeter here? Used to be Ann Jeter. I mean, hell, I'm thinking. Where are you? There you are. Excuse me, Ann. I'm 70. Ann is in my brain. I know y'all know if you're my age or older, there's a tape up here that has things we know. And when you're young, the tape goes like this. Then when you get to be my age, it kind of goes like that. Here comes Ann. There went Betsy. All right, Ann, this goes to you. Are you still at Pine Street?
Well, I retired last year.
Congratulations.
I was a good teacher for 40 years, then things started getting strange. All the children were named after places and things. I said, but you're people, children. I'm a person, I'm a human, a woman. I was an English teacher and a bit of an amateur writer myself. But I'll tell you, things went so far off course, I just didn't even know where I was anymore. I think it was the beginning of the end, too. What once was generous compassion for high school students with all their angst and crap going on turned into pure agitation and fury. I didn't get frustrated by who I am. I got frustrated by what they were reading and wanting to write about. I said, you're too smart for all this shit. Dwarves and wizards and gnomes and vampires. Big blue aliens with tails like monkeys. I said, what I wouldn't give for a good old-fashioned story about somebody losing his or her virginity or getting an abortion. Grandma died and for the first time I knew I was mortal. Or what about the one where the boy doesn't want to kill a deer, but granddaddy makes him so he can be a man? I was wanting to write something myself, and it was dying to get out of my head, but couldn't find the door. It was also plugged up with that malarkey. I had worked so hard, and all I was longing for was some whining little boy who didn't want to kill a deer. I was craving one, in fact, would have loved him and given him an instant A. And where did all the orphans go? Jane and Oliver and Pip? It's an honorable and very dramatic position. And the girl who's upset to have a period, where did she go? Or the one all torn up about losing her virginity, where did she go? If they're still out there, they're keeping a low profile and hiding from all those getting boobs for Christmas and graduation and making themselves up to look 30. I wanted dead deers and dead grandparents. I wanted anything other than a zombie or a shape-shifting demon wolf coyote. What am I to do with a bunch of aliens at Armageddon? Some of them said about their papers, I meant to be vague. Like that might excuse something that didn't make a damn bit of sense. Or the one who said I just didn't get what he was doing because it's so brilliant. I took my work seriously, and where did it get me? There I was asking for a little reality, and who wouldn't be after Columbine? What teacher on the planet after Virginia Tech didn't study her classroom windows and doors and the desk arrangements and hatch some plan for how she would protect all those young bodies, even the ones that got on her last goddamn nerve? And then this one boy, meaning to push my button, this one boy named something like Montreal Fedora, offered up some literary criticism on the death of Julius Caesar. He said, and I quote, them dudes was mean as shit, weren't they? And I said, those dudes were mean. That is what I got in trouble for. Some kid in there ran home and tattled, not about what was being discussed in class, but that the teacher said shit. Miss Tyler, come to the office, please. Miss Tyler, please come to the office. This had happened many times. I made a notch on my desk, in fact, every time it happened, and one whole side looked like a fine-tooth comb. My principal was about 14 and had never read Shakespeare. How do I know? I asked him one day. And in that moment when I needed him on my side, I almost wished that I had not done that, or that I had been a teacher who did not argue against prayer in my class, which I had done for years, or did not allow hats. But what in the hell did I care if they wore hats? Some of them might have been sporting bad haircuts they were ashamed of or keeping their lice locked in. What did I care? I didn't tell on kids who refused to stand for this or that either. I figured we'd have plenty of battles to fight, and I needed to choose the most important. I mean, these are humans growing up and witnessing the uterus as a competitive sporting arena. Who would have ever thought that? Irresponsible birth control will get you a television show and a magazine cover. Octo, sexto, moron. I said to my principal, the boy king, I asked him, if I retire like you say I have to, who will teach these children? Who will guard the gate? Who can promise me they'll tell the boys to keep their trousers zipped and tell the girls not to go promising what they don't intend to deliver? Who will teach birth control? Who will teach the value of literature? I said, who will tell them nobody gives a shit about how dwarves and trolls have sex? If they had, the brothers Grimm would have figured it out and already done it. What I wouldn't have given for just one stained soul, just one good stained soul, one good story.
All right, we're going to do one more song. This is it. I always preface this telling people I grew up in the Jim Crow South. And by the way, it's great to be back in Spartanburg. My, it's changed. Talk about it, I get lost in my hometown. I'm staying with Jennifer, like right where, near where the State Theater used to be. It's a, like a place to live. With bathrooms and everything. But when I drove to Dorothy, we all had dinner at Dorothy and Julian's last night. Oh, my God. But that's another story. But I got lost trying to find Union Street from downtown because I was, well, anyway. I never intended to make it this far. I never had a fallback plan. I always thought I'd go in a blaze of glory, a blaze of glory. Burning like a comet across the night sky, playing rock and roll music with my hair on fire. Every show was a blaze of glory, a blaze of glory. Glory. I saw Elvis Presley back in 1956. The world was different then, everything was fixed. When he walked out on stage, it shook us to the core. That colored balcony came crashing to the floor in a blaze of glory. All right, I got a part for y'all to sing. Everybody out here, y'all help me. La 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 da 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 da. See you sing that. Every morning at the break of dawn, I brush the sleep out from my eyes. I've got to see that sun rise up in a blaze of glory, a blaze of glory. Thank y'all so much. We love you. great to spend an hour plus not thinking about Washington. You know I had to say that. And I thought I'd just, I'm going to read this. I used to have a monthly column at this magazine in Nashville. They told me I could write about anything I wanted to. So I took the gig and I wrote 99 columns, and then the guy had a heart attack and the magazine ended. I was just working on my 100th column. But I've only written one thing about politics in my life, and this is it. And I just love y'all, so I want to read it to you. Boy, is that a setup. I have never let politics stop me from loving anybody. If I did, I'd have to stop loving half the members of my family. My father, who voted both sides of the fence, once described my mother's politics as, quote, to the right of Attila the Hun. Daddy always voted for whoever he thought would win. He had to, since he was often in Washington lobbying to control textile imports. He'd vote for Strom Thurmond, then turn right around and vote for the moderate liberal, Fritz Hollins, which drove Mama crazy. One time, some people approached my father about running for governor of South Carolina. I can't and stay married to Martha, he said. I'd have to divorce her first. Mother was known for speaking her mind. My greatest fear was that I would end up like my mother. You know what? You're looking at her. People often joke that compared to Mother, Martha Mitchell was shy and retiring. One of the greatest disappointments of my mother's life was that three of her four children ended up Democrats. I remember one time during cocktail hour. This was during the 1988 presidential primary. Anyway, she was sitting in the living room, practically in tears, as she sipped from an old fashioned. I survived the Great Depression, she began. And I survived World War II. Pause. But nothing, I mean nothing, has upset me as much as two of my four children voting for Dukakis. Another pause as she takes another sip from her old fashioned. And Jamie voted for Jesse Jackson. As this, at this point, Mother came as close as Mother can come to wailing. Jamie was her baby and only son, James Alfred Chapman IV. 8 years later, he would die from AIDS. Now, it's been a strange election year for sure. And I imagine my family is a microcosm of America itself, divided and unpredictable. I'm just grateful we're all old enough now to be respectful of each other's differences. In closing, I'd like to share something I heard Billy Joe Shaver say one night when we were performing an In the Round at the Bluebird Cafe in Nashville. There were four of us singing songs and telling stories, just having a big old time, when suddenly the subject turned to death. Somebody quoted Woody Allen, "I'm not afraid to die, I just don't want to be there when it happens." Then Billy Joe, being Billy Joe, said, "I have a feeling when I die, I'm gonna wonder why I didn't do it sooner." Which makes me wonder if heaven has politics. Probably not. Probably why it's called heaven. Thank y'all. It's been heaven tonight. playing for you. Thank you for coming out and supporting the Chapman Cultural Center.
Thank you.
God bless you. We love you.